It's a beautiful thing for us when we can put two writers on the same stage who just seem to belong together. And that's certainly the case tonight with George Saunders and Karen Russell. Dazzlingly original, beautiful, dark, and funny. Words that could be applied to both of them. And they're both MacArthur geniuses. Karen Russell has spoken repeatedly of the debt she owes George Saunders. "He always makes me want to write," she says, adding, "he showed me you can have really moral, moving stories that are partly a function of how insane and absurd the setting is." George Saunders published his first book, Civil War, Land in Bad Decline, in 1996. Since then, there have been two other collections, Pastoralia and In Persuasion Nation, a novella, The Brief and Frightening Reign of Phil, a children's book, and a collection of nonfiction essays and short humor pieces. The 10th of December is his latest story collection. Karen Russell is the author of St. Lucy's Home for Girls Raised by Wolves and the novel Swamplandia. Her new collection is Vampires in the Lemon Grove. George Saunders and Karen Russell appear tonight in conversation with Judson True. Please join me in welcoming them all to the JCCSF.
Welcome, Karen. Welcome, George. Great to have you here at the JCC in San Francisco.
Nice to be here.
Thought I'd start out with a fun question that builds a little bit on Barbara's introduction. Both of you set a lot of your stories and your novel Swamplandia, Karen, in very weird places. Theme parks gone wrong, or some version of that. What is it about these kind of weird theme parks that attract you both, and what were each of your favorite theme parks when you were young? Not that you're not still young.
I know, I can barely remember that time. Well, thank you so much, Judson, for moderating. It's super cool to be here. This was mentioned already, but I was a huge fan of George Saunders' stories early on because there are all of these demented theme parks. And I grew up in South Florida, which is itself kind of a demented theme park. And then it's just kind of nested dolls within that one macro theme park, you know, just simulacra of a simulacra. So I think that what's attractive to me about them is, in a way, they feel kind of like stories, in a sense. It's like this diorama universe, and it's bounded. It has these constraints, which is sort of how, like, a 12-page story versus a novel can feel. I mean, you have this kind of machinery to work within. And then I think, it's a great question. When you're writing a story, I think to set up the rules of that world is part of the pleasure, to really create your own sort of engineer your own little artificial universe. Yeah. So that's for sure part of it. But I really think, in my case, a lot of it just has to do with geography, like growing up in South Florida. So many of our weekends and field trips and everything, there wasn't too much of a distinction between real life, quote-unquote real life, and like the parrot jungle.
The destination and
yeah.
the trip.
Yeah, and that was my favorite, the parrot jungle.
The parrot jungle?
Yeah. Yeah. Which my dad, who's in the audience, has since told me not a great place to go if you have a hangover and small children.
What about you, George?
Well, I when I was younger and trying to learn how to write, I had this Hemingway fixation. And so I was always imitating Hemingway, and everything was in that voice. And I think at some point I got to the place where that had to get disrupted in some way. And I had a dream one night about this place. It was one of those mystery spots, you know, where gravity is suspended. And in the dream, I was the proprietor, and it was this living room, and everything was floating around, and I was behind a pane of glass working it, you know. And in the dream, this elderly couple came in, and the guy touched something he wasn't supposed to touch, and I snapped at him, you know. And I woke up, and I had the language of that place in my mind, but which was very Hemingway-esque. But when you take a Hemingway's diction and put it in a theme park, it's automatically funny, you know, that the Virgin Mary theme park in Stoic diction, it feels. So I think actually at first it was just a mechanical way for me to cure myself of this medical condition called Hemingway boner, you know. So if I started getting a little too earnest, which is something I'm well, that's very not correct. You laugh at a medical condition, but if I started to get too earnest, I would, or, you know, too sincere, no, too sincere, too sincere, you know, too direct. You put it in a theme park and suddenly you don't know what it is. And then you're in that relation to your prose, which I think is ideal, which is, I don't know what I'm doing here. Suddenly my intention has been mangled in some way, and you're writing in that state of kind of real mystery and befuddlement that then produces something, you know, more than you planned.
Some third-term thing, yeah.
Sure. Do you feel like over the course of both of your writing career so far that America's become even more like a theme park, and it's even deepening as an attractive metaphor, or do you feel like, you know, it's played out for you at all?
I think in this new collection I sort of as a conscious deviation, because I had just spent, I don't know, my entire 20s in these imaginary theme parks, so in Florida, in the state of Florida, I think there's a little bit of a move for me. But definitely, I do think that it's a frightening new normal, where just, the poverty of our imagination is sort of everywhere, right? If you go to Orlando, Florida, I don't know if Book Tour took you down there. I actually love Orlando, but you're just, it's like the B-side world, you know? It's like... Yeah. Lions eating steaks on cars right next to, you know, like this city brought to you by, I don't know.
I love that. You know, when I had what I now can see as a formative experience, when I was in my 20s, I was living in Amarillo, Texas, and this close family member of mine passed away very tragically. And it was just, you know, the first devastation that we'd actually experienced. And the funeral was held in this sort of new faux Georgian funeral home on the main strip. And across the street was a strip mall with a Chuck E. Cheese. You know, so that, to me, primary American experience now, which is to have all the old classic, emotions, grief, sincere grief, love, and then be in a situation that's sort of hard to reconcile. The rat comes out and has a smoke while you're grieving, you know?
Right. And it's so funny that you mentioned that, because I remember at our grandfather's wake being just enraged or having some kind of displaced rage, you know, connected to grief, because people were eating like hot Cheetos like inside the funeral home. Yeah. And I was like, why is this happening? But it seemed like the wrong kind of invasion.
But it gets interesting because then
you didn't actually go from the funeral to the Chuck E. Cheese. You didn't do that.
No, I mean, but just to come out with that rich, you know, complement of human emotion that people have been feeling since, you know, since they loved, and then be in this kind of odd setting. But the thing I'm thinking about recently is maybe that's my problem. Maybe the fact that we conceptualize something as odd, you know, is sort of a programming. You know, what would be an unodd situation in which to be grieved?
You wouldn't be able to see something that completely takes you outside of the feelings you're supposed to feel at the funeral while you're doing those. But that is a big part of, I think, both of your work, is that you feel all these different things at once. You crack up. You get really scared of death. You worry about poverty. How do you both think about how your work kind of does evoke all of those different feelings across the spectrum? I think that's one thing that's really distinctive about both of your work. It's not just sort of hitting one, you know, sort of strand of emotions. Right. What do you think, Karen?
Oh, thank you. It's so funny. I love. I've always loved reading George because there's that pleasure sentence to sentence where it just feels to me like you're micro-adjusting. I was watching, you know, those guys, you crazy people with your extreme sports on this coast where, you know, they're just time on a Sunday, I think I'll just launch myself off a cliff and fly around. But, you know, just making these like tiny adjustments tonally. And I think I think partly because, George has said this elsewhere, the awkwardness of doing this with you is now I can't just plagiarize you.
I can't give you my shtick, so like, we're in a fix here. We're going to have original thought. Oh, my God.
Get your lawyers on the horn.
Well, as Karen once said, I said.
we could do total baudrillard. You know, but there's life has so many registers. Life is always multivalent, you know? It really isn't ever. I think that's what can feel kind of false sometimes about Hemingway boner earnestness, is you're like, well, I'm sure sometimes it is that monochrome, but more often than not, you're cracking up or you're really in grief, or you can have a stab of romantic disappointment even as you're terrified of some, you know, total cataclysm. I think all of that can be happening at once.
Yeah, I think, I mean, for me, I found that the actual process of writing is to try to keep that kind of thinking suspended. Because I think if you went into a story saying, now I got to remember to get grief and hilarity, you know, then...
it's a Jenny Craig ratio.
Note to self, you know. But I think that for me, it's more like just imagining that you are a first-time reader, you're reacting to your own work, and you're trying to be really friendly to the story, but also sort of hostile to it, and say, how are you doing? And there's a meter in your head saying, I'm doing great. This is so good. The first page is really wonderful. Uh-oh. You know, and then at that point, instead of panicking, you say, all right, you know, dear story, you know, what's the matter? And he says, I suck. And he, no, you don't suck. Tell, you know, be more specific. And he'll say, you know, well, I'm a little boring. Yeah, well, you are, aren't you? You know, but then you start to look for the exact point, you know, the place between sentence 3 and sentence 4, or the place in sentence 4 where you've made a kind of mindless repetition, or where you've said something to the reader that she could imply otherwise. Right. Sometimes just plucking that out. And you know, so I think that's where the micro-adjustment is a perfect way to say it. You know, when you're riding a bike, you're just shifting, you know? Mm-hmm. And for me, anyway, when I'm doing that, the result often will have those things in it because it's too boring for them not to. After many passes, you know, you feel a wave of sort of boring sincerity, and you say, I gotta just send me a fart joke, oh Lord, you know, and then kind of.
That's true. I have that too. That's so funny. It's just whatever acid reflux.
I can see that you do in your prose.
Self-created acid reflux. Where I'm like, well, that was pretty lyrical,
right,
you know, and you're gross.
Right.
I think.
But see, then I think.
Send me a fart joke for sure.
Right, but the thing, and what I see in your work is that then you don't necessarily disown the lyrical. You can leave it, and just say, okay, the reader is now feeling as I just did. That's a little lyrical. Let me surprise her, you know. And so it's like a date in that way, I guess. You're kind of trying to.
It's tricky, right? You know. I have a really difficult time figuring out when humor, you know, when it's sort of in the surface of the story and it's gonna underscore whatever's really poignant and dark and terrible, which is like all, you know, the funny sad ratio that the George Saunders stories just rock, and then also, or when it's sort of just a reflex.
Right.
Because sometimes I'll that happens to me too, where it's too bald or it feels too sentimental or something, and then it's.
Yeah, but you know, well, I mean, we've met a couple times, but one of the things I love about meeting you is that you can see that in a really wonderful writer, the prose style and the person are not unrelated. You know, so you really have a genuineness and a comic energy just in the way you live, which is.
Isn't it weird for you guys when I start crying on stage?
I'm like, and I have this special award for you.
Thank you all for being here for the best moment of my life. Thanks for coming. Thank you.
But I was, you know, I teach at Syracuse, and it's a great program, and the students are amazing. But one of the things I every so often I think, you know, maybe one of the built-in flaws of the MFA program is that when you think about writers like Karen or Zadie Smith or David Foster Wallace, these people that really become iconic and beloved, there's an element of it which has to do with personhood. And you know, obviously you can't teach personhood. So it's a matter of, like, David Foster Wallace was a really interesting, unique person who found a way to show up in his prose, you know. And that you can't, you know, it's just, you're lucky if you have it. And so,
yeah,
but,
I do think that that's a tricky thing. And that's a weird thing to try to transmit. Just thank you so much. That is the best compliment in my life. I'm just trying to keep walking forward since we're on stage. But
Karen, do you remember when you were first writing stories, when you felt like you found your voice? Like, do you remember a moment?
It's funny, because that's a shifty thing, too. I don't know. Maybe we could I'm so curious to know what we're supposed to do now.
Yeah.
Speaking of micro-adjustments, because I feel like the stories in St. Lucie's, which is his first book, I just feel like, you know, a person's a moving target too, so I'm certainly not the same author that generated that work.
So there's not, there wasn't, there's not
there's
a moment
a through
like that.
Line,
it's
I hope, or
it's a, yeah, there's
a sociopath,
definitely through line,
and I mean, I hope there's, that would be scary, total dissociation.
Maybe now would be a nice time to give everybody a little flavor of each of your great collections. You want to read first, Karen, from one of your stories? I think that they're both just amazing collections of stories, and it was interesting for me to read them together because there's some themes that I think are connected too, and I think we have a little bit of that with these two selections. So, if you want to read and set up the story a little bit,
yeah, for sure. Thanks, Judson. So this is called Reeling for the Empire, and I just geeked out on Meiji era Japan. I was reading about female debt slavery in this book by David Graeber, called Debt, which shockingly was of great interest to like everybody in every country. So I've been reading about female debt slavery, and this is sort of like a nightmare of a story. I was thinking of it actually just as a distortion that's really a new way to tell what's sort of a historically true story about these silk workers in Meiji era Japan. And what was interesting to me was this was this time when the nation's coming out of this really isolated feudalism. They're being kind of wrenched into trade with the West very violently, and in one generation, after 200 years of being basically, you know, completely isolated, they adopt Western-style capitalism. And there are these young women are sort of duped into working at these, they believe they're kind of prestigious European-style factories, and, you know, the reality is pretty grim. So this is a story about young women who are literally turned into pieces of factory machinery. They're like, actually turned into silkworm hybrids, which is, you know, not so far, horrifyingly, from what actually did occur. So nobody needed that much setup. Sorry, guys. I'll just start reading now. like, now I've explained the joke that I'm going to tell you. Several of us claim to have been the daughters of samurai, but of course, there is no way for anyone to verify that now. It's a relief in its way, the new anonymity. We come here tall and thin, noble women from Yamaguchi, graceful as calligraphy, and short and poor, Hida girls with bloody feet, crow-voiced and vulgar. Entrusted to the model mill by our teary mothers, rented out by our destitute uncles. But within a day or two, the drink the recruitment agent gave us begins to take effect. And the more our kaiko bodies begin to resemble one another, the more frantically each factory girl works to reinvent her past. One of the consequences of our captivity here in Nowhere Mill, and of the darkness that pools on the factory floor, and of the polar fur that covers our faces, blanking us all into sisters, is that anybody could be anyone she likes in the past. Some of our lives are quite bold. Yuna says that her great uncle has a scrap of sailcloth from the black ships. Dai claims that she knelt alongside her samurai father at the Battle of Shiroyama. Nishi fibs that she once stowed away in the imperial caboose from Shimbashi Station to Yokohama and saw Emperor Meiji eating pink cake. Back in Gifu, I had tangly hair like a donkey's tail, in mouth like a small red bean, but I tell the others that I was very beautiful. Where are you from, they ask me. The castle in Gifu, perhaps you know it from the famous woodblocks. My great-grandfather was a warrior. Ah, but Kitsune, we thought you said your father was the one who printed the woodblocks, the famous ukiyo-e artist Utagawa Kuniyoshi. Yes, he was, yesterday. I'll put it bluntly, we are all becoming reelers, some kind of hybrid creature, part kaiko, silkworm caterpillar, and part human female. Some of the older workers' faces are already quite covered with a coarse white fur, but my face and thighs stayed smooth for 20 days. In fact, I've only just begun to show the white hair on my belly. During my first nights and days in the silk reeling factory, I was always shaking. I have never been a hysterical person, and so at first I misread these tremors as mere mood. I was in the clutches of a giddy sort of terror, I thought. Then the roiling feeling became solid. It was the thread, a color purling invisibly in my belly, silk, yards and yards of thin color would soon be extracted from me by the machine.
Mm. Wow. So
thank that's
you.
The chance. Oh, thanks, guys. Yeah.
Thanks, Judson. Well, come out to read, I always feel self-conscious because my stuff is so dark, so I try to pick something that's not mordant.
And then that's a different strategy.
Yeah. But this is at a funeral, so, you know, so this is at a funeral. This is just a diary entry, so the diction's a little clipped, but October 1st, Todd Grassberger funeral today at Ukrainian church downtown. Todd apparently from humble roots. Priest equal long-haired guy in cassock. Sings chants whole service in Ukrainian from memory. As he chants paces, cassock rope swings. Scary guy. Very intense. Sermon. Why this surprising? Did you think you were going to live forever? only difference between you sitting there anticipating the rest of your day and Todd in coffin, bound for eternal home in cold earth, is heartbeat. Feel that, people? In your chest? That is thin line between you and grave. So why do you live like you're eternal? That foolish. You are fools. This scary? It's not scary. This truth. This reality. Shouts. Shall we wake up? Shall we? Everyone's staring big-eyed at priest, except usual congregants who seem to have heard all before. Priest goes on. Which of us will die tonight? Do we think he's being facetious? That shows we're dopes. Any one of us could die tonight, die right now, suddenly come up short of breath, keel over in pew, be with Todd in earth in wink of eye. Suddenly from downstairs kitchen, smell of roast beef. Happy chatter from church ladies down in kitchen. Smell of roast beef plus sound of pots clanking, plates being set out, equal appealing. People shifting in pews due to amazing smell of beef. Todd's two brothers come to lecture and make tributes. Older brother, Todd, sweet. Todd, funny. Todd, a powerful force in his life. We'll never forget wonder that was Todd. Younger brother, yes, Todd, super strong person. Todd, equal bull. Although Todd could be somewhat firm, Todd did younger brother much good in long run by teaching him how to stand up for himself. That is to say, having been pushed around by Todd throughout entire childhood, nothing can now faze younger brother, i.e. no bully in outside world will ever be equal of Todd. But Todd's so great. Todd the best. Todd's so smart, so good looking. No wonder Todd's mom plus dad always treated him, younger brother, like afterthought. But Todd's so caring, so perceptive, Todd understood this. Would sometimes console younger brother by saying that he, younger brother, was perfectly fine in own way. Often just before breaking pact they had made, re Wednesday night being younger brother's night to borrow dad's car, thereby ruining younger brother's chance to see girl he really liked, possible love of life. Girl he eventually lost, dope from Selden. Dope whose own older brother, apparently more inclined than Todd, to give his younger brother decent shot at family car. Younger brother, seemingly perplexed by own tribute, then led away from lectern by scowling older brother, hissing something in undertone. Lunch good, lunch beyond good. Funeral so sad, lunch equal heaven. Eat three roast beef sandwiches in row off paper plate. Outside yellow tree blowing in wind. Think, life beautiful. So glad I'm not dead. If when I die, do not want Pam lonely. Want her to remarry, have full life. As long as new husband is nice guy. Gentle guy. Religious guy. Very caring, plus good to kids. But kids not fooled. Kids prefer dead dad, i.e. me, to religious guy. Pale, boring religious guy with no oomph, who wears weird sweaters and is always a little sad due to cannot get boner, due to physical ailment. Death very much on my mind tonight, future reader. Can it be true that I will die, that Pam, kids will die, is awful? Why were we put here so inclined to love when end of our story equaled death? That harsh, that cruel, do not like. Note to self, try harder in all things to be a better person. Although, that does make two boner jokes in one evening, so I think we've reached the limit on that one.
I saw the Hemingway influence too, with the problem that the new dad had, kind of like Sun Also Rises.
Yeah,
there was
still
some Hemingway circling back there.
That's right.
I think both of those passages really show just the sort of the bravery and the willingness to use your imagination, but also drawing on reality. I think that both of you play with science fiction. The story that you read from is, you know, arguably, you know, has a science fiction influence. How do you consider that fantastical science fiction-y aspect of your work while you're also trying to do, you know, the serious work of literature, or you know, the things that we expect more from literature than we do from science, from genre science fiction.
Right. Well, I think one thing you do is you don't make the distinction, you know, or maybe you focus on the third thing, which for me would be some kind of emotional engagement. So then you're saying, all right, I wanna get an intimate communication with my reader by any means necessary. And as you're doing that, you're kind of saying, all right, I'm gonna need this. And you know, if you subjugate those categorizations to something deeper, then I think you just take whatever out of your backpack that you need, in sort of in the spirit of micro-adjusting that we talked about earlier. If things get a little serious, it's funny. Sometimes the rhetoric of a story needs, for me anyway, needs a kind of Greek chorus that might be a ghost, or you know, or the frame of the story has to go beyond life, you know, just for rhetorical reasons within the story, I think. You know?
No, I totally agree. And yeah. I was thinking, as a writer I admire a lot, Jim Shepard, sometimes he'll throw this amazing Venn diagram up on the board. It's not, you know, super sophisticated, but I think it just is true, where he'll, you know, he often does the same kind of ventriloquy, or he'll have a story, you know, Nazi Yeti hunters, or he'll do some amazing kind of jump. And it's always in the service of getting at some emotional truth. So he'll say, you know, Jim Shepard, neurotic writer dad, you know, Yeti hunter, and somewhere in that Venn, he's got to find his way in.
Right.
I do weirdly think, for, you know, it's really similar. A story, I'll have, like, my sister who's here will just, like, you know, call BS on a million terrible ideas for stories that don't come to life because I was unable to plug into something that feels really emotionally resonant or true, you know. So that's kind of like a Deepak Chopra mystic answer, but I stand behind it.
I think the idea is a big enemy. For me, an idea with a capital I is a big enemy. I say this too much, but it's become my mantra, which is that Gerald Stern quote about, if you start out to write a poem about two dogs fucking, and you write a poem about two dogs fucking, and you wrote a poem about two dogs fucking.
You connected those dots. Yeah.
I mean, that to me says everything.
Because it can't surprise you, right? There's not that incongruous gap you were talking about, where, well, now what is going to happen? Yeah. I have just invited these totally disparate elements to collide. What's going to be the result of that collision?
Yeah. Yeah. Because otherwise, there's an element of condescension where you say, dear reader, sit there a minute. I've got this, you know, manure truck full of ideas I want to dump on you, you know.
Right.
Yeah, so that's, I mean, that sounds good on paper, but of course it's hard to execute that, because it's so terrifying to supposedly be a writer and not know what you're doing. That's what Bartholomew in that famous essay said, that's your job.
Right. I also think it's humbling when, you know, you have that kind of collision and something very similar occurs yet again. I don't know if you've had this, but I'm like, what if, you know, whatever, what if a seahorse ran a popsicle shop? That sounds wacky.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh no, it's about grief again, you know? No, I'm like, oh.
Right. That's right.
Somewhere between embroidering its little hat and the new paragraph, it became about loss.
Yeah.
Cool.
But I think that's true. You know, it seems to me like if a person focuses her attention on something very intensely, it's going to turn out to be, I mean, it should be somehow part of who she is, and there should be some consistency in it. But I love that feeling where you think, oh, this story is totally new for me.
Right.
I've never written this before. And then at the very end, you go, oh, wait a minute.
The B horror movie feeling, right? Where, like, that same cab driver turns around, you're like, you again.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, you grief lady.
Check the license plates. It's what
right.
you.
Yeah.
One thing, though, besides the emotion, you're both also amazing at plotting, at keeping. PLOTT, not DD, but you know, and keeping it moving, you know,
gotta get that beer where it's going.
But and I think, how much of that is because you both write so many short stories? I mean, what is it about the short story that might make it more plot dependent, or plot is more important for short stories, perhaps? Do you think so?
I think that's, at first I have to strongly disagree that I'm good at plotting. I think that compliment can go over the enemy to George for sure, and really have always admired that. And I think for me, it's funny, I rely a lot on editors, you know, and other readers sometimes to help me find the shapeliness of a story, because just my process is funny. I'll just generate so much more material than could ever be called short or a story, you know? Just kudzu sprawl of stuff, and it takes me a long time to find, you know, the topiary shape inside that kudzu. But I do think that one of the great things about a story and finding a premise that's sort of wacky for me can do this, it's really constrained, it's really bounded then. Mm. So, you know, that Reeler story, there's a lot of pressures. There are a lot of narrative pressures on that story. There are these girls, and when I started writing, I was like, well, I know that they are in a factory, and they're trapped there. And so you've got some spatial constraints. There's some sort of like, you know, weird science fictional, historical, you know, lyrical, fantastical constraints on the voice and stuff like that. And I think that can really help. So then the plot was sort of straightforward. It's kind of like, well, how are they gonna, this is an unbearable situation. I'm just gonna keep putting pressure on them inside this box until they have to find a way out. Right. And I have to find that as a writer in some kind of Houdini way too.
It either gets better or it gets worse.
Yeah.
Usually for both of you,
it's usually escalation, right? I think it generally gets worse in a short story, which makes it really scary in life. It turns out then all dialogue feels really fraught and terrifying, I find. Yeah. They're like, oh, the lake looks frozen today. I'm like, oh my gosh.
That's going to go badly.
New paragraph. I'm like, it's not.
That's going to go. Yeah, I always thought the story world is funny because, you know, it does tend to be downhill. Like if you had Little Red Riding Hood, you know, and the story was, once upon a time, there was a little girl and her mother told her not to talk to wolves, and she didn't, you know, that's not much of a story, you know.
But it went pretty good.
Yeah, it went fine.
Wolves were good conversationalists.
Everybody was reasonable.
George, your plots come out really quickly. Do you kind of just see the whole story and how it just come out?
No, never that, no. For me, it's more, I do a lot of revision, a real obsessive revision, and I think the trick is to, if you imagine it as an intimate conversation and the story kind of as a compressed machine, then my job is to rule out the easy, lame plot developments. Carol Bly was a really wonderful short story writer, and she came to Syracuse when I was a student. And she said, part of your job is to know what most people would expect and then do something that encapsulates and transcends it. So the example she used to use was that if you have a story where a guy pulls up to a gas station and the attendant is weeping. Now, most of us think, oh, his wife left him. And she said, exactly, that's what you think. So do something else, you know. Or do that and be cognizant of the fact that you're sort of disappointing your reader if you do that. So for me, it's about doing a lot of drafts and one, you know, I'll go to one plot point, write it really thoroughly, polish it, and then go, I don't know. Come back out and do another one and another one. And at some point, you see that there's one plot that so-called plot development that jumps you past to two or three banal things. And Rick Kegalkin said one time that if you do that, you get credit for the three banal things. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? In other words, everybody goes, yep. And somehow in that intimate relationship, the reader really appreciates that you've jumped past the banalities and respected her intelligence. So for me, the only way I can do that is by kind of writing out the banalities and then discarding them at some point. You know, but so that makes plot, actually. You know, you go from something, an expectation is generated, the next thing includes and goes past that, and you're like, oh, well, now we're really going somewhere, you know?
Were you trying to do something different with this set of stories? They've had an incredible reaction from the way 2013 started with a cover story in the New York Times Magazine that said, this is the best book you'll read this year, and then you're on Morning Joe on MSNBC at 5 a.m., right? I mean, what was different about this collection for you, or do you think it's just been received differently?
Nothing. I mean, the only thing, you know, actually, if we had talked before the book came out, I was wincing a little bit because I thought that the reviews would say he's become a realist. He's softened too much. Because the story maybe, none of them are really realistic, but some of them are a little more realistic. So I was kind of wincing for that. So I think that there might be something to that. But I actually, you know, this is written over 7 years, or maybe 14 if you count that one story that took me 14 years to write. And I think
the story you read from took 14 years to write.
But I think you just get older. And in while the book was written, our daughters grew up, they went to college, and all my fears about what could go wrong, most of them didn't, you know. So I just became aware of a real current of gratitude, and I thought, well, if you're feeling that, it would be kind of weird if you kept it out intentionally, you know. So I was trying in small ways. It just hit little plot moments to say, well, you know, is there a way in which things sometimes go well, so it becomes a technical thing, really. And I think just so over the 7 years that the sum total was maybe a little more something, you know, hopeful, or I don't know, but still pretty dark. But.
And Karen, what's it been like for you with the new book of stories coming after the incredible success of Swamplandia? How did that feel to you? And did you write them at the same time? Were you writing the stories during Swamplandia, or did they come after?
No, you know, it's funny. About half were written in some form before Swamplandia. I don't know if that's a healthy way to divide one's life either.
Short story or novel.
Or just sort of like before Swamplandia and then out, and then the rest were after. And it was about the same period. I think there's the earliest one in there is about these presidents reborn as horses, and that's I wrote when I was 25, I think. So it's been about the same.
Where did you ever get that idea that presidents should be reborn as horses? I think that story is incredible. But it's only some of the presidents, and they have their personality still from when they were president. And then John Adams.
That's my happy story. That's the happy one. Yeah.
And then John Adams shows up, and everything kind of goes haywire.
Yeah, that asshole. It's so funny to do the forensics because people are always curious about that, and I think that's a totally reasonable question. But they're just things are pretty fast moving in the old cerebro. I think sometimes that origin story can feel like a fiction too. But what I do remember is I had just read this amazing book by Kevin Brockmeyer, who's a writer I love, called A Brief History of the Dead.
Oh yeah, that's a great
book. It's gorgeous. Yeah. And his idea is that what would be a brief history of the dead? Oh, it would be our lives, you know, because you're bounded on either side by sort of like roaring eternal darkness. It's actually a very beautiful book. Don't use that on the jacket copy. But what I loved about it was just that it felt so true. He has these people go to like a limbo. When you die, you go to a limbo, you remain there until the last person alive who remembers you also dies. And then, I don't know, then it's just skee-ball to somewhere else. But these people in the city were just like, well, what the hell gives? Like, they had sort of had this faith that it was going to be nothing, or there was all their questions would be answered. And they found themselves in a place that seemed a lot like this place, where their questions had an afterlife. They were like, well, what the hell, what are we supposed to do now? I don't know, I'll make the bread. You know, everybody kind of worked it out. So I had read that, and I guess I was thinking about these powerful men, these presidents who seem so concerned with their legacies in this life being stabled in some kind of afterlife that was as bizarre and baffling as this world.
One of the other incredible, I think, commonalities in your work is the not just theme parks, but concerns about people on the margins and poverty and compassion that I think there's no moralizing, but it's incredibly moving to care about the characters. Do you feel like you've always cared about people who may be not doing as well or are struggling, or did that come from some of your own experience?
I think I always cared about them, but I didn't really have the chops to get at it, you know. Then also in my life, it was kind of like money was always a thing, you know, for me. And I recently found an old notebook from when I was in my Kerouac years out in L.A., which I remember as being real, you know, just kind of hanging out and, you know, taking acid and, you know, not taking acid, but hanging out. But, you know, just carefree. And
it was
and
after Hemingway?
Yeah, lots
it.
Of intellectual things. But I looked at this notebook, and it's just like, I think I can get $40 from Greg, you know. Call Brian, see if parking lot job's still available. You know, and it was actually really kind of sad because I had this poor little 28-year-old guy who thought he was so hip, and he's like a 95-year-old retiree, like with the pennies, you know. And I was working as a doorman in Beverly Hills and trying to, you know, somehow parlay that into something better. So I think that those concerns were always with me, but then for many years I didn't think that was a valid topic. And then with the first book, I kind of blundered into a way of writing about it that brought it to the center kind of surprisingly. But, everyone I know, and when I was a kid, that was anything you tried to pull off in your life was bounded by the fact that you had to get up at 6 and go to the morning, you know, or you, that Terry Eaglin quote you're talking about, capitalism plunders the sensuality of the body, you know. And so I guess it was good that it finally made its way into the stories.
Wow, what a great quote. Yeah. Capitalism plunders the sensuality of the body.
I can't find that he actually said that. I can find bell hooks quoting him, so I might just cannibalize it.
Sure,
as I often say.
How did, he's a communist theorist, how did Joe Scarborough react when you quoted that to him?
Yeah, I slipped that in there, and then afterwards...
You got that on the Morning Joe?
Yeah, I
did. That's amazing.
And then afterwards, whoever the token liberal was said, hey, Joe, you know, that this guy just dropped some communist theory on you. He's like, it's a cheap thrill, whatever.
No, it's a good one. I've been thinking that since this MacArthur thing. I'm like, I should learn the Germans and quote them aggressively.
I think you should, yeah. It's in the contract. You actually have to do that. Yeah.
What about you? I mean, I think that Swamplandia, I think, is is incredible because of the compassion for these kids that are, you know, the loss of their mother, and then just really the loss of their world. And it really is tied up in poverty and money, and kind of you find out more in the book about that and about their father. But where did that come from for you?
That's funny. I know, I want to have a fun, like, so I don't know, I'm a child slumlord. I have no idea. I think I just had a really wonderful parents, both, like, just when people say salt of the earth, they mean my own parents, and they're just completely compassionate. You know, and I was raised Catholic, so that helps, I think.
You have that in common, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's where that maybe anxious... That's,
when I say scapular, you know what I mean.
Well, yeah. Not a euphemism for anything weird. No, just actually... Yeah, I just think that... I had like a... was just cued into that early on. And both of my parents came from, you know, blue-collar backgrounds and worked incredibly hard to give us... They're a lot like the parents in a George Saunders story, you know, I think. And one of the ways that, like, in retrospect, I understand that love to have worked now is our home was destroyed in Hurricane Andrew. So that's sort of, was sort of like my first experience with seeing kind of like what it can mean to lose, you know, everything for just the entire population of Miami, basically. And yet they did such a good job of kind of protecting us from the reality of what that meant that I was just like, oh, more time to study for the spelling bee. Awesome. You know, like... I mean, I just think that kind of resilience and love and compassion, all that you get, that's kind of a too earnest answer now. I want to make that fart joke, but I'm just keep.
I mean, something I've noticed is that when you fiction might be sort of empathy inducing, because if you're revising, at least for me, you start with a character, and often my first impulse is comic, and the character's down here, and I'm up here. So you're giving them a little kick, you know. And then often what I found is I'll get locked up halfway through a story because he's too low. I'm puppeteering to the character, and the form resists that. Because since you're inventing everything, if you invent somebody who's deplorable and then point it out, that's kind of, you know, it's an empty gesture. So I've had this experience of a story getting stuck in the middle until I will figure out revising ways to bring him up, you know, onto my level, and then the story can proceed. So I had a story called The Barber's Unhappiness, which is about this ogling middle-aged barber, and I was having so much fun. He was a guy in our town who I had, we had our two daughters, and so I was kind of a born-again feminist, you know, and I was having a great time kicking him, but the story locked up because he was so far beneath me. So because I'm not subtle, I have to, you know, make him more estimable. So I just said, okay, oh yeah, he doesn't have any toes on his feet. And that, you know, that was my compassionate stroke for him. And but yeah, sorry, buddy, you got to take those off. But what's funny was that all of a sudden he changed for me. You know, yeah, it was like, oh God, no wonder he's so harsh with women. You know,
right.
or there'd be scenes where
I had to be all the toes, though, right? Because if it was just the big toe, you'd be like, get over it.
Well, I tried that, and then you know, you three toes, four toes. But it is funny because then suddenly he became not first an object of sort of pity from me. And then he started becoming me. I started giving him more of my sort of legitimate thoughts and feelings. And then about the time he got up just close to where I was, the story took a turn and it could proceed. So it's really interesting how being honest about your own stories can actually kind of train you in that bit from Philadelphia's story, you know, the time to make up your mind about people is never. You know, likewise with your characters, you can keep coming back.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Karen and George, for talking to us about your work
thank
tonight.
You.
We can't wait to hear questions from the audience. So thank you very much.
Got the first question right here in the front row.
Oh. Hi, I have a question for Mr. Saunders. Mm-hmm. I noticed that there seems, and this is not in any way a criticism, that...
That's always a good way to start.
depictions of more visceral violence have sort of crept into your stories over the years, you know, with stuff like, you know, The Red Bow or Escape from Spiderhead. And I was wondering if that is any sort of reflection on, you know, the way you perceive the world around you or things in your life happening. I was wondering if, is that the result of anything or...
No, you know, the other kind of mantra I've stumbled on this year was Flannery O'Connor said, a man can choose what he writes, but he can't choose what he makes live. So I don't really like being a violent I don't like violence. I'll give you my whole Luddite screed about Hollywood, you know, the whole thing. I don't like it. I don't like cruelty. But somehow, when those things get into my story, they light up, you know. So then you'd be kind of a dope if you, you know, if you said, well, I don't want any violence in my stories, and your stories sucked. You know, then you know, so my thought is, well, you put whatever goes in, and then in the revision process, you're trying to account for it or exploit it or react to it in some way that's humane and kind. But I think you have to be a little bit of an, you know, a freedom-loving person, and when something uncomfortable gets in, you have to bless it. You know, and so I don't really have any, I think my early stories are really violent too, in a way, you know. So I think you just have to sort of say, I want to get this boat to float, and then you have that kind of uncomfortable moment. You go, "Oh my God, I did that!" You know, or you. So yeah, I don't have any real answer for it except that you do what you have to do to get it to vibrate a little bit, I think.
Our next question over here on your guys' right.
This is a question for Karen Russell, and I loved Swamplandia, which you originally was in St. Lucie's, and I think it should have won the Pulitzer that year. But anyway,
you.
I just wanted to find out whether you had anything in Vampires that is developing into the next novel.
Oh, gosh. I love, you know, in my, like, fantasies of how the thing could work, there would be something in there that was just quietly growing without my assistance or knowledge, and one day it would be a novel. Like, that is my actual dream. I've had that dream where, like, I, like, turn the computer on. I'm like, oh, good. It's done. That's cool. Now I can watch TV. No, you know, I wrote one story in here with fabulous editor Michael Ray of Zoetrope, which everyone here should subscribe to if you don't. It's based out of San Francisco, and that was set in Nebraska. And it's not part of this new novel I've been working on, but it's sort of the same setting and some of the same preoccupations with kind of people's relationship to their landscapes and violence, too, in that same, very similar. I'm like, oh, I didn't know that I'd be stabbing and stabbing, but yeah. I feel a frisson. Yeah. I guess I'll continue. So that's sort of some of the same kind of territory anyway. Yeah. But I think that I'm happy to say check, please, with the vampires and the silk reelers and leave them at their current length. Trying to turn that story into the novel, I say it was just like playing the accordion badly for a long time.
Yeah.
So, thank you so much.
The next question, excuse me. The next question's up here to your left.
Hi. I really enjoy how both of you can write from the perspective of children. In Swamplandia, the narrator you chose, Karen, and then George, the first one that comes to mind is the kid on a bike in Pastoralia. Mm-hmm. And I'm just wondering, how you get there, how you get into those characters. Does any of it come from observation, or how do you write from the point of view of a child?
I just try to remember my own sort of mental phenomenon as a young kid, and maybe exaggerate it 5 or 10%, but I think I had a really vivid childhood. I did a reading in Chicago last year, and the first girl I ever kissed showed up. And luckily, I'd been stalking her on Facebook, so I was prepped, and I could. You know. But we were talking, and at one point, she kind of stepped back and she said, "You have a really good memory for things that happened when we were kids." And I thought, "Oh, maybe I guess I do." I always thought that everyone did, but I can really remember, you know, thought streams and kind of thought patterns. So when I, like in this new book, there's a story called Victory Lap, which is a 15-year-old girl. So I just took myself at 15 and changed the gender and put a couple of surface things on. And then kind of wrote it, and at one point realized that I had identified the essence of myself, which was this attitude: what is wrong with all the grown-ups? What's all these divorced alcoholics? Yeah. Wow! If they don't want to do that, all they have to do is stay married and don't drink. You know, that was that
right.
Kind of like
troubleshooting. You know, yeah, 11-year-old troubleshooting.
Yeah, but in doing her, she that came, and I've sort of forgotten that I was such a little asshole. But
yeah. Yeah. I love that story so much. I was amazed at that story. It's as if you were a 15. I mean, how you were a girl that age, I do not know.
Well, you
also
know,
just all like the weird cultural crap you import as a girl, where you're like, I guess I'm a princess. I don't know. This was the material available to me to make a fantasy life with, kind of stuff. So
well,
funny.
It's a fun, strange.
It's that font. That's the font it's happening in.
Yeah, it's kind of a strangely hopeful thing, because if you can think your way into the mind of a 15-year-old girl, then we maybe have more in common than we think, you know. If, or you can do a 97-year-old Holocaust survivor, and then maybe we're not quite as separate and as we think. You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
But how about you?
I find I'm always drawn to either sort of in Swamplandia, right, this like tomboy alligator wrestler girl, or just like really effeminate hyperverbal boy. So I don't know. I don't know what that's about. Yeah. But I think that childhood was similar, just such a visceral time, really raw, really vivid for me too.
It's also interesting. I think people can do three or four. I can do like three voices, basically. Yeah. So then your trick is to sort of try to tweak them and parlay them so they might maybe six. And then you'll die and you'll be all right.
Isn't that interesting? I did this story, this vampire story. I was like, well, there, that's an adult. He's like 700 years old.
Yeah.
He still sounds a little like a teenager, you know? I mean, it's a little like a teenager. Right. And I think, too, there's something about, I like to like my characters. I have a harder time writing someone totally despicable, right? I like to empathize with them. And with a kid, there's that like wounded innocence that I think is, there's a way that we don't forgive it in adults anymore sometimes, you know, if there's someone who's really totally bewildered or baffled. I think that we're hard on ourselves too, you know, you have that contempt.
Right.
And with a kid, you forgive a lot. Right. So if someone's really having a hard time with loss or as a kid, you extend your sympathies.
Hmm.
That's good. Great question.
My next question over here on your right near the back.
Hi, I was wondering from Karen Russell what you like best about your work and what's up?
No, sorry.
Oh, and then George Saunders, what you liked least.
Wait, I want to hear more about the rationale of this question.
Yeah, really.
Is it like supposed to be equally hard for both of us?
I guess like when, you know, I feel like everyone has something they really like about themselves and also things they really despise about themselves. And, you know, I feel like a lot of the conversation so far has been like, oh, George, your stuff is so great. But I feel like
what's wrong with that?
He probably has...
That's all my subjects.
It's good.
Bouncer.
I also feel like, you know, you might have a little self-loathing. I do. You know, I think I'm a great person, but I also find myself a little self-loathing.
Sure.
So
I think we should say what we like least about you.
Yeah.
That would be
I think that's a very generous question. It's funny. I was just talking with Vendela about this. We were going over new strategies. I was like, self-deprecation has seen its day. So we're going to try shocking confidence. Obviously, that hasn't panned out evening.
Right.
But we're going for shock and awe confidence into the new millennium.
Right.
I think one thing that I like about my work is validated by Jordan kindly is that I try to be multivalent. You know, I try to be representationally true of how many kind of tones and registers we've got going in this, our only life, and kind of how much can be happening just moment to moment. So that's that.
Now, am I saying what I like least about my work?
Yeah.
Is that it? That's easy. I think that when you get to that place in a writing life where you finally maybe stumble on something you can do, it's kind of a bittersweet moment because you find out that, one, it's related to who you actually are, which is sometimes you don't like that.
Yeah.
But second of all, that your strengths and your weaknesses are just the same. They're the same thing. So for me, when I made a little breakthrough with the first book, I realized that I had to let in humor, speed, pop culture, sort of not classic things, you know, kind of, so I know how to do that. But then the flip side was I was sort of disappointed, you know, I wanted to be more classic. Mm-hmm. So the thing I like least is that I still find myself relying on, humor, clipped, high velocity, sort of understatement. And it can easily become sort of your thing.
Yeah.
So I like that about my work, but I'm also trying to overturn it as I mature, you know? So I think you're always dealing, just like personality, you find out when you're 17, oh shit, I'm me, you know? But then you say, well, yeah, shit, I'm me, you know? And so I think that.
The next question's
right here.
The
news is mixed.
Yeah.
Sorry. The next question's right here in the middle.
I actually have two questions. I don't know if I'm going to get to do both, but the first one is for George Saunders, and it's got to do with different characters that I've been reading in your books. When they die, and there seem to be consciousness after death. Mm-hmm. And so I wondered what your thought, in a couple of different stories, I wondered what your thoughts are about that.
Well, in this, I mean, in the story world, I just needed it, really, you know. And so, in a sense, you're just drawing on a convention, kind of like the Sunset Boulevard convention, or something. You know, it's just. But since I've done that, I'm pretty sure there is consciousness after death. I think it'd be really weird if there wasn't, actually. So, I mean, apart from writing, I'm quite confident that there is, and there's all kinds of ancient traditions that would back me up on that. You know, the Tibetan Book of the Dead, and you know, and so on. But in the writing, it's just a technique, you know. It's just like, well, this has been done before. The story, you know, the story doesn't quite seem done yet, and I need to hear from somebody, but it's a first-person narrator who's dead, so am I allowed to have him talk more? Sure, you know? I mean, really, that it's just a technique. Yeah.
And your second question?
It's just about, for both of you, the writing as in a short story form rather than a novel, and how do you always start out knowing that's what you're going to be doing, which form, and why you chose that form.
Yeah, I think in my case, I really had novel envy. I was in an MFA program, and I had been writing exclusively stories, and these people had these like long committed relationships to novels that looked so good from the outside. And I had written like 40 pages, and I thought I was Tolstoy, and it was like the longest thing I'd ever written of this story called Ava Russell's The Alligator. That eventually then kind of sprawled into Swamplandia. And what was different about that than the stories I'd been writing is I didn't have that check please feeling. I mean, I was really still completely mystified and kind of obsessed with and couldn't stop thinking about that world and particularly this relationship between these sisters. So that, it was sort of, I felt kind of helpless against it. I love that Flannery quote, right? You can't help maybe what you make alive, or maybe people will say things have their own literary DNAs. I'm still trying to feel that out. Now I'm in this awkward long story territory where what is that? It's like just this gangly
Novella Lita.
Yeah, completely.
I only faced up to this reality recently. I wrote a novel when we were first married and we had our daughters were babies. And I was trying to write us, you know, my wife had been married once before to a really wealthy guy, and I was really feeling my kind of inadequacy. So I went to a wedding in Mexico that was really dramatic. There was a radical Catholic priest and a male surfer model, and I thought, this is it. So I came home and I said, honey, I got this. You are sitting on a gold mine. We're gonna do this, you know. So I wrote this novel, and I was, you know, working full time, so I'd come home at night and drink one or two pots of coffee and a bottle of Boone's Farm if I could come up with it, and write until 4 a.m, the whole thing. So for about 2 years, and I had a 700-page draft of this book that you'll see how good it was. It was called La Boda de Eduardo, which I think means like Ed's wedding, you know. So I gave it to my wife, and I just remember she read about 3 pages and was just sitting there with her head in her hands, like, and really, I was so burned by that. I just cannot imagine investing 3 years in something. Really, you know, and
it's true.
So.
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. It was very painful.
The last question is right here on your left.
I'm wondering if each of you could describe your writing process. Do you have to set yourself hours that you're going to work? Do you ever have writer's block? How does it work for each of you?
I've been, George has been too. I've been on book tour for a bit, so on book tour I just lie and say what I believe would be my ideal writing schedule, yeah. The way you lie at the doctor's office, where you're like, oh, I exercise and I drink minimal wine, you know, whatever. Yeah. I'm like, I write 5 hours a day most days, which is just simply not true at this juncture. It's changed a lot. It used to be sort of, I was a night owl, and now in my decrepitude, I write in the mornings and then try to revise later in the day. But I wonder if this is true. If you're really into something, that's like all you want to be doing.
Yeah.
So it really kind of is a function too of how excited I am by something. If it's not going that well, then it's harder. And if it is, that's all you want to be doing.
Yeah. The only thing, I try to write when I'm happy. And if I'm not happy, I try to get happy. So like, and for me, it's like even just to go to the store sometime and come home, I feel kind of, you know, energized. But I just, The main thing for me is to always have something on my desk. So I think since 1989, I haven't had an empty desk, even if it's just a little fragment. So then the main thing is just like say, I'm not writing. I'm just sitting here in this room where I write, but I'm just writing. And then sort of pull the story forward and say, yeah, still not writing. I don't have to do this, you know. And then at some point, read a line. And at that point, you're still not writing. You're just reading. But you have an opinion. And there might be a red pen nearby. And then you're writing, you know.
You're writing. And you'll work on multiple stories, kind of.
Yeah.
I love that. I do that, too. Do it's you? Weird. Yeah.
Because then you never have to work on something that you don't like.
Yeah.
You know, you can feel. Yeah.
Yeah. Because then what good could come of that?
That's right. That's exactly
it's
right.
A no-brainer. Yeah.
So both of our authors will be signing books in the atrium. Thanks to George Saunders, Karen Russell, Judson True, and thanks so much to all of you for coming.
Thank you.
Good night.